Level Up with Winnie Sun.
Well, hello, friends, and welcome back to the show. Happy Tuesday to you. What a treat to have you with us. And if you're joining us on a replay, a big hello to you as well. Thanks so much for tuning in. And to my friends at Modern Mom, you know we're streaming to you, and you mean so much to us. So thanks so much for being here. I'm Winnie Sun, your host, Forbes contributor, CNBC council member, and award-winning financial pro, here to keep you on top of relevant, trending business entrepreneur news. But more importantly, you're part of today's discussion. And let me tell you, we have such a special treat saved up for you just in moments here. So you're going to want to stay tuned because he is an entrepreneur that you're going to have on your radar and you're definitely going to want to meet. Let's start with the market, let you know how it closed. Now, unfortunately, today was sort of a triple down day on the stock market. The Dow closed down 39 points, the NASDAQ down 6 points, and the S&P also down 6 points. But, you know, what's going on? As you know, there's been a lot of news about what's happening out of Afghanistan, more talk about the pandemic. But here's also breaking news that came out about Social Security. Now, Social Security trust funds, my friends, those of you who are working, paying into your Social Security taxes, well, unfortunately, it looks like money's going to run out sooner than expected, partly due to COVID. This is what the Treasury is saying, because according to an annual government report that was released this week, the Social Security Trust Fund was supposed to be able to supplement many of our retirement funds in the future. But unfortunately, it's projected to run out in as little as 12 years. Crazy. So obviously, because people aren't working as much, and some people have had to take early retirement or just retire completely because of the pandemic, not as much money is going towards Social Security funds. And it's also lowered the GDP by expectations of 1%, not just temporarily, but actually in the long term as well. So the financial outlook for Social Security and Medicare, two of nation's really important safety net programs, have dropped considerably over the past year. So unfortunately, COVID has now really made retirement just a little meeker. So you'll want to tune in. We'll have a lot more ideas and strategies on how to mitigate that. But tens of millions of Americans like you and I, probably not too excited that, you know, Social Security might run out. We're going to make sure it's here for us when we retire. Now, in other news, let's segue to something a little more positive, and that is market research report by Grandview Research found recently that global streaming is now worth more than $42 billion in 2019 and is expected to grow by more than 20% per year to reach a total of $184+ billion in 2027. So if you're in a streaming business, you're probably having a much better day. Now, time spent streaming has also increased by more than 58% before the pandemic. So imagine what it's doing now. Well, today's guest, I'm so excited to introduce you, because it's the one and only Rob Fishman. Rob, thank you so much for being here and welcome to the show. How are you?
Good, thanks. Thanks for having me on. Hope you're well as well.
Well, we are in for a treat, because thank you so much for being on the show. Rob, let's go your intro real quick. The co-founder of the very popular Gen Z network, Brat TV. And I'm going to tell you, this is an area my kids go bananas for, so many of the shows that you produce and share for so many of us. The studio behind hits such as Chicken Girls, Total Eclipse, Attaway General. Prior to launching Brat TV, Rob founded two major companies. You know, some of you just think, well, you know, I'm just busy enough just to get the house cleaned up and going to work. But actually, Rob has now founded two companies in addition to this multi-million-dollar deals with Twitter, Niche and Kingfish, and BuzzFeed, respectively, earning a spot on the Forbes 30 Under 30. You know, Rob, is there anything you can't do? Because it sounds like you've done a lot.
Well, I don't know that I could host a show like you, so there's that.
Well, you know, I highly doubt that. I'm sure there's not much you can do. And I know you're based in LA. So, and Brat TV originally appeared on YouTube, but now is available on Hulu, Roku, Tubi, Samsung TVs, and very, very popular now, NBC's Peacock, which I know a lot of people have been tuning into because of the Olympics as well. So thank you so much for joining our show. We thought we would have a little fun with you, Rob, because, you know, the streaming network, or streaming, I should say, it's almost like a streaming generation, right? So many of us grew up watching regular TV, and now we're moving to watching streaming. This must be very exciting to you. You must be busier now than ever.
Yeah, I mean, one of the great things about launching on YouTube, which is, you know, actually the world's largest video destination, is that for young people, that, you know, they go there every day for television-like content, and we've been able to establish a really great foothold with this with Gen Z, with this younger generation, by putting out television-like content, which, as you mentioned, has now found an audience on many of these new streaming platforms, among them, on-demand platforms like Hulu or Peacock. And we also have live linear channels that are kind of 24-hour programming on places like Samsung TVs.
Yeah, that's wonderful. And it just seems like there's going to be more outlets and more distribution channels for you. So we're excited to see where this takes you. But for those of you watching, I want to say a big hello. I see Vicky joining us from Facebook, Robin joining us from Twitter Live, so many of us on YouTube Live as well, and LinkedIn Live as well. Thank you so much for being here. Let's have some fun. We had some trivia prepared, Robin. I want to see if you know the answers to this. And if you don't, maybe some of our audience will jump in and help you with this. Because according to a recent Nielsen Total Audience Report, users were surveyed on how they selected which of their streaming providers. So, you know, 84% of users ranked this as their top consideration. So let me ask you, do you think it's ease of use? Is it the variety of availability of content? Streaming playback quality, speed of menu selection, which is a big one. I love it when it's easy to surf and find content. Or is it cost? I see many of you jumping in. If you know the answer to this, you want to help Rob. I'm sure Rob knows the answer to this. But if you know the answer, if you want to help him, I'm curious to see what you think. All right. We'll give you a second here. Well, Vic, Rob, we got a lot of fans of you here. It says you are an inspirational person. This is great. Okay, Vicky is saying B, variety of availability of content. Rob, what do you think? I mean, this is obviously something you must know very well.
I don't know the answer, but I'm inclined to agree with option B. At least that's what I would pick.
See, that's one I would pick too. But well, this probably isn't quite surprising, given, you know, the broad spectrum of everyone that we see a lot of people are now saying B as well. But actually, the answer came down to cost. You know, and being that Level Up is a business show, I guess it kind of works with us. But yeah, people are more concerned about cost than selection, which is really interesting. I don't know, Rob, for me, it actually is selection. I love it when I have a lot of choice. My kids have a lot of quality things to watch on TV, and it's just easy. So interesting. Well, I think that'll change after you watch our show today. Let's also go to question number two. Now, this one is a good one. And that, who binge watches the most, do you think? Do you think it's Gen Xers, Gen Zers, Millennials, or Baby Boomers? All right, so those of you watching, joining us here with Rob, let us know, who do you think binge watches? Which audience binge watches more than anybody? Let me tell you, I feel like I know this answer because my little ones are downstairs. And yeah, there are some shows I probably have watched 30 times, and I can almost memorize the words, but they seem to still enjoy watching over and over. All right, let me ask you this, Rob, what are your thoughts? Who do you think binge watches the most?
Well, it's a good question. And, you know, we actually don't put out our own shows as binge, so to speak. Episodes come out once a week, a little bit more like how they used to appear on television, in part because, you know, we think that's a healthier way to consume content, you know, episodes every week. So, but despite all of that, I guess I'll go with B, Gen Zers, but I'm sure I'll be surprised and be wrong again.
Well, no, actually, you're right. You're absolutely right. So a 2019 Canadian study by J.D. Powers actually showed that 55% of Gen Zers and Gen Y, in fact, millennials, do binge watch, and only 24% of pre-boomers or baby boomers. So definitely the younger generation is two times as likely to use streaming apps than older demographics. And so we got a lot of people like, wow, that's a big number. That's true. So I think that it goes to show, you know, we all wish we were Rob right now, but let's dive a little bit deeper and learn how Rob became Rob. So let's start with this. You know, we've heard about trends with Gen Zers. Everybody's interested in that next generation. Millennials are starting to feel a little older. Gen Zers are sort of the new kid on the block. And obviously the way that they consume content and just things in general, advertising and everything else is so different. So Rob, what trends do you see in the Gen Z TV space, if you will?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the things that's interesting about Gen Z is they've been one of the primary accelerators of, you know, so-called cord cutting. And of course, they're watching and consuming so much video on their phones as opposed to, you know, through the cable networks that we all grew up on. And I think that that's presented both a challenge and an opportunity. It's obviously a challenge for traditional broadcasters and advertisers who want to reach this important generation, which is why you see so much activity on places like YouTube and Instagram and TikTok. And so I think for us, that's been a great opportunity because, you know, we've been able to launch our shows on YouTube where there isn't a lot of other kind of television-like content because most of that is still happening in the TV ecosystem. And so we've definitely seen that migration from Gen Z from, you know, television to the phone. A corollary to that, which is, you know, is interesting is they are spending a huge amount of time looking at screens, up to 8 or 9 hours a day. And, you know, that can be not only watching serialized or video or vlogs, but also gaming and kind of other, you know, messaging and so on and so forth. So kind of across the whole mobile ecosystem.
That's so interesting. Well, Brett TV has been doing so well during this pretty challenging year, right? The pandemic's really challenging for so many industries. So obviously Brat TV is sort of stand out. Can you talk a little bit about what's really worked in your favor?
Yeah, well, I mean, for one thing, you know, we have a really amazing production team who has implemented all of the, you know, COVID and PPE protocols that we needed to keep filming for as much of the past year and a half as we could. Obviously, there were times when we were unable to shoot, but we've been able to keep kind of sets up and running as much as possible, and therefore continue to broadcast our shows to the folks who watch them at home. So that's been, I hope, an advantage. You know, just the perseverance and persistence that we've been able to display. You know, we've also been able to find some really amazing, great talent to work with. You know, early on in the pandemic, we'd actually already shot this show, but we released a series called Attaway General with Dixie D'Amelio, who at the time was kind of emerging as one of the bigger TikTok stars in the world. And since then has become such a huge, she and her sister have become such huge presences on the internet in general. So you know, in addition to that, we have new seasons of our show Chicken Girls with a brand new cast featuring the original star Jules LeBlanc's sister, Haley LeBlanc. So there's kind of a fun turnover there. Plus really a really fun new show called Charmers about some teen witches led by a great cast. And so, you know, I think we've been able to see what our audience has really liked in the past and then kind of continue serving them newer and iterations on what we've worked on before.
I love it. So Rob, what keeps you so young? I mean, you obviously have a great understanding of like the younger generation and what sort of shows and programming that they're interested in. What sort, like, I mean, I'm even thinking as a parent, I'm looking at my kids. I don't even know sometimes what really captures their attention. How do you do this to keep having these successful shows go one after another?
Yeah, well, we have a really amazing team of creatives and talent scouts and folks who work here who are able to identify new creators who are kind of bubbling up and gaining an audience. And then we have some really amazing creatives who work with different writers and creatives to come up with really fun show concepts. So, you know, I think part of what we do that's a little bit different is we try to think a little bit of like all that's old is new again. And, you know, as I said before, we don't release our shows in binge. They come out once a week and they're very serialized and narrative driven. And, you know, when you think about a lot of these Gen Z audiences who didn't necessarily grow up watching the same sort of television that people our age may have, you know, watching the WB or kind of that touchstone teen programming, for them, watching narrative television-like content feels in some ways kind of novel because this is a generation that otherwise has, you know, grown up on TikTok and Instagram and kind of seen more user-generated content than past generations. So I think one of the advantages we've had is by marrying some of the kind of time-tested production and storytelling values with some of this new talent from online.
Yeah, so brilliant, so brilliant. And they already have audiences that people love. So we actually got a chance to meet some of your charmers, your cast of charmers. And they were so fun and just such a talented group. So congratulations on that. And also congratulations on your partnership with NBC streaming service Peacock, which many of you know, because we just talked about the Olympics just a couple weeks ago, how popular Peacock has become. So how did that relationship come to be, that relationship with Peacock?
Yeah, you know, so as folks like NBC have launched their own streaming services, Peacock included, you know, they've been looking to expand their content offerings. And, you know, having been in business now for several years and putting out a healthy library of shows, we've been able to forge syndication deals with folks like Peacock or Samsung or Amazon Prime, where we take our shows that we've made and kind of rebundle them into, you know, television episodes that can air on these services. So, you know, we were just launching on Peacock. We've been on some of these other platforms for about a year, and we're seeing, you know, really great audience development there. And I think new folks finding us who maybe haven't seen us on YouTube or Snapchat or any of those other platforms.
I love it. Well, let's talk Gen Z. Okay, this is, I mean, Rob, we have you in the house, and I feel like you are such a wealth of knowledge, especially for this new demographic, the Gen Z and entertainment. You know, this is a market that many want to reach, but they're having a hard time reaching them, and more importantly, just understanding what sort of content they want. And obviously, you and your team have done a great job. So this next generation wants to see on television content, I mean, what's in the future for you? What do you think is sort of the next things that you can see that Brat TV is working on to be able to address them? And are you already looking at the generation then even younger?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think one of the things that we're trying to do as a company is always, you know, stay ahead of the ball and make sure that as these new platforms emerge, we are establishing a presence there. You know, so over the last year, for instance, we've developed a bunch of really neat unscripted hosted shows that appear primarily on Snapchat's Discover platform. So one of them is called Past Your Bedtime, which is a really fun, you know, three times a week broadcast where we talk about all of the kind of happenings and gossip among of the creators who Gen Z really loves to follow. You know, we're thinking a lot about audio now. There's a bunch of cool platforms, including Spotify's Green Room and Clubhouse, that are doing some really cool live audio shows. We've been working a lot with our friends at Facebook and Instagram to help them with some of the production of some new creator shows for the Facebook family of apps. So, you know, we're definitely trying to stay ahead of the ball as this audience moves and migrates and make sure that we establish a presence there. I think that answers your question. I think you had a second one too, but
no problem. No, that definitely answered my question. But you know, Rob, you know, I'm watching this, and I know a lot of people, all of you, are watching us live. Thank you so much for doing that. You know, a lot of people are watching and thinking, wow, you know, Brat TV, Rob, they've been really successful in securing like amazing creator talent to star in your series, right? Is there a formula that you figured out that works really well for you? Because a lot of people are saying, well, we want these sort of people in our projects, but you've done it.
Yeah, I mean, we really try to work in close partnership with our talent. And, you know, we always keep in mind that these are highly sought after, you know, creators, and some of them are just starting and some of them are super established. So, you know, what can we offer them that makes this really unique? And I do think that one of the things we've done is established a bit of a environment where folks who, you know, have grown really popular on TikTok or Instagram and who want to get into acting, you know, we can be kind of the first place that they come to play a role, to play a character, to be on a real set, and to get that kind of more Hollywood experience, either in a way that, you know, it just feels friendly to them. It's them and their friends, and they're, you know, doing something really fun. And so, you know, I think we have one foot in this kind of social media world and another in the more established Hollywood system. And I think for creators who are just getting started, we can be a really, you know, great first step. So I think it's really about offering something to the talent that feels novel and exciting. And at the same time, you know, they're helping us to continue to grow our reach and our programming and the franchises we've been building out and sharing with our fans.
I love it. Let me ask you this, Rob. So like if you had a wish list, right, for that the next project that you were working on, sort of what type of talent? I mean, a lot of people, young people are probably watching and saying, wow, I wish, you know, I would get on Rob's radar. What sort of person or people would you think that would be of interest to you and your team in the future? Are we looking just at big reach? Are we looking for a certain bit of charisma? What are you looking for?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the answer to that question is a little bit of everything. And, you know, we've always tried really hard to have all kinds of different, you know, folks and faces and personalities on our shows. And, you know, in just the past few years, like we've worked with Sky Brown, who I believe won an Olympic medal for skateboarding, which is super cool. We've worked with, you know, so many different people from all kinds of different backgrounds. And some of them, yeah, are super popular on places like TikTok and have a huge audience. But a lot of the talent on our shows are, you know, super accomplished singers or comedians or, you know, athletes, or, you know, we a few years ago worked to add another athletic example, work with Ryan Garcia, who's now one of the most popular boxers in the world. And this was when he was really early on in his career. We've worked with folks like Anna Cathcart, who we saw on the Netflix show To All the Boys I've Loved Before, playing kind of the little sister character. And then we're able to work with her and give her own kind of headline show, which is super, super fun. I mentioned working with Dixie D'Amelio before, and I know you talked to Brooklyn and the cast of Charmed, who have all done, you know, really amazing things on their own channel. So, you know, yes, there are a ton of actresses and dancers and performers who have kind of built a great audience online, but a lot of the folks who work with us, you know, are just really getting into the field, and, you know, we meet and they then go on to develop a really great career. So we have a lot of different projects, a lot of different shows, and we're always looking to make sure we have, you know, really great diverse casts across all of them.
Well, I love that. Thank you so much for making sure everybody is inclusive and includes people from all different backgrounds. Rob, it sounds like, you know, you have a pretty awesome job. You think that's fair to say?
I think feel lucky to get to do what we do and keep doing. It's been a really fun few years to work on this company. I think, you know, we've continued to grow, which is great. And we've, you know, it's funny, a lot of the early cast members of Chicken Girls are now kind of growing up and going on to do all this other cool stuff. And it's amazing to kind of see the passage of time. And I've been able to work with so many really talented folks over the last few years.
I know. And I'm sure many look, I mean, it's almost like you're growing your own homegrown talent. It's kind of exciting. I'm sure you're like the cool cousin or the cool uncle that's watching these kids sort of blossom up. So it must be very exciting. But you know what, Rob, today's about you. And it wouldn't be complete without a little bit of some fun. So we're going to have a speed round. Let's do this.
Cool.
All right, my friends. So Rob is in the hot seat, you know, so we're going to ask him two questions and give him 60 seconds to answer. So the first question is, Rob, what was your first job? Tell us what you did.
Cool. Yeah, my first job was as the social media editor for the Huffington Post, which was a really fun job in Soho in New York. And, you know, it was still fairly early when Arianna Huffington had started the website with some other great folks. And, you know, I think it was really an interesting time to be there, in part because it was, you know, pre-social media. And so Arianna, I think, in many ways was a sign of things to come, which is a really forceful individual personality who establishes a huge audience online and turns that into a really cool business. And, you know, sometimes when I think about the creators we work with who are just getting started, I think in some ways the Huffington Post was kind of a template for how you can take your kind of personal brand and turn that into something that really impacts a whole industry. And so that was where I worked in the beginning, and we ended up becoming part of AOL and kind of went on from there.
Rob, that's amazing. So that was your first job. Most people, like, first job, they maybe like deliver mail. I don't know. They did, you know, maybe worked at a fast food restaurant, but then you worked just alongside Arianna Huffington, who I have had pleasure to do some work with, and handle social media. That's, Rob, I guess you were an overachiever even in diapers, which we'll take it. We'll take it. All right. So second question to you, my friend, is this. Okay. Let's do a little dreaming here. Elon Musk, Oprah Winfrey, Steve Jobs, Jennifer Lopez, and Jeff Bezos have all called. They're on hold for you right now on your phone. Your assistant is like speed out, like just pounding on your door. Which call are you going to take, and which meeting are you doing with these individuals?
Wow, it's an exciting hypothetical. You know, I'm rereading the options here. I mean, it sounds like it would be a good group to get all of them.
Your team hug.
I suppose we're only allowed to choose one. I mean, I think, you know, from a, at least from a company perspective, you know, working with someone like Oprah would be probably the most exciting. I mean, she's managed to become, you know, a household name to so many people in this country and around the world, and done so in a way where I feel like people think of her not only as a, you know, a personality, but it's sort of as a friend. And I think that when we thought about what Brat TV was and what it could be and how we could work with these awesome young emerging internet personalities, it was kind of with that goal in mind of how do we incubate our own sort of household names and our own household shows and build that kind of, you know, nation and worldwide credibility that, that she's managed to establish. So I think that, that would probably be the answer.
That's a great answer, Rob. I'm curious, like, if you could do a show for Brat TV with Oprah, what that would look like. Do they, does Gen Z even know Oprah? I don't even know. So,
yeah, it's hard to say. I mean, we're always surprised by who they don't know and who they do know. And, you know, right. some folks have enjoyed, you know, kind of these crazy second acts on TikTok where, you know, memes will get shared and suddenly they're totally familiar with people who were around, you know, a long time ago. So it's always a little hard to say.
It's hard to say. Yeah, I'm really curious. On that note, I should mention happy 91st birthday to the one and only Warren Buffett. His birthday was yesterday. So hello, happy birthday, Warren. All right. Thank you so much, Rob. If people want to learn more about Brat TV and, of course, you and follow your journey, where would you ask them to turn to?
Well, just go check us out on YouTube. It's all free and available to watch.
I love it. Brat TV, definitely on YouTube. Thank you so much, Rob, for being here and so generous with your time. And thank you so much for being an inspiration for so many. I see so many of our audiences saying, wow, they're just blown away by you. Thank you so much also for those of you who've tuned in, watched, and supported our program. Please take a moment to share this show with your friends, as always. And remember, you can find full episodes of Level Up on NASDAQ, Amazon Fire, and Roku. So be well, and I can't wait to see you again this week. Take care. We'll be right back.